Good afternoon, everybody. It's a great pleasure for being here. I think I have 5 minutes and 37 slides. Okay, I'm going to talk about the Behçet syndrome. This is my outline of talk. You know, the Behçet is a complex multifactorial disorder. And the first time it's described by the Hulusi Behçet, who was a Turkish dermatologist, and first description was published in 1937 in German journals, and they call it three symptoms at the beginning for the description of Behçet disease: oral aphthous ulcers, genital ulcers, uveitis. And still we are having diagnosis with these three symptoms most of our patients. And as a description, as you all know, that Behçet syndrome is a chronic relapsing remitting occlusive vasculitis affecting multiple organ systems. And the disease is characterized by oral and genital ulcerations, uveitis, and skin involvement, arthritis, thrombophlebitis, colitis, or Crohn-like diseases, and CNS involvement. If you look at the epidemiology, the disease is very prominent in specific areas, especially in Mediterranean area or Middle East, Japan. But the most prevalent area for the Behçet disease is, we can say, Turkey. And the disease is generally showed itself between 15 and 45 years. And generally, it prefers the male genders, actually. You can see in these slides the different prevalence of the disease in different countries. If you look at this number, the 370 per 100,000 people, it's very high prevalency. And if you look at the European descent, it's, in German, for example, it's 1.5, or in France, for example, if you look at 2.4. Also in United Kingdom, it's 0.64. In United States, it's 5.2. Etiology pathogenesis, still we don't know, and there are too many, research as a clinically or as a science, as a basic science, performing, but still we have limited information about the etiology and pathogenesis. We know very well the HLA-B51 association with the disease, and we know cellular and humoral immune mechanisms are involved in the disease pathogenesis, and there are some studies that showed, the abnormal neutrophil reactivities, and from the biopsy specimens, we are able to show the deposition of circulating immune complexes, and we know very well the vasculitis. And still, disease is as a puzzle, and you can see in here again the different hereditary and environmental risk factors for the disease: HLA-B51, male sex prevalence, or the latitude, especially between 30 and 45 north. One of the other risk factor, or some studies also showed that there is an association between streptococcus and HSP recognition by T cells, and these are also able to flare the disease again, this especially streptococcus and HSP. We know very well the familial aggregation. And as I said, HLA-B51 association with the disease described in 1973. And again, there are so many studies that show the innate immune response and adaptive immune response also responsible about the pathogenesis of the disorder. And if you look at the innate immune response, non-specific hyperactivity or Pathergy phenomenon is related with the innate immune responses, and we showed that increased expression of pro-inflammatory cytokines, and we know very well the neutrophil-rich inflammation in Behçet disease. And if you look at from the adaptive immune responses, CD8 and CD4 T cells already have playing a role in the pathogenesis of the disease, and we know T helper 1 type polarization. And because of this, actually, the disease also classified, Behçet syndrome classified in mixed pattern diseases, not pure autoimmune or not pure autoinflammatory disorders. And also, during the last Chapel Hill Consensus Conference, the disease classified as a variable vessel vasculitis. I think Professor Özen, actually she's my mentor, and she was one of the person in that consensus conference, and then I think she supported this idea and put there the Behçet disease as a variable vessel vasculitis. And I just want to share one of the, I think this is an important issue, because this idea coming from the Turkey, from the Istanbul University Cerrahpaşa Medical School, there is a really very big center about the Behçet disease. Hasan Yazıcı et al, I think, governing that center, and they have more than 10,000 Behçet patients in their center. And they claimed that Behçet syndrome has in some subsets, and they divided as a 4 subsets the disease: solo skin mucosa disease with no major organ involvement, and another group of patients that just with the eye disease, and the third group is seronegative spondyloarthropathy-like disease, and the fourth group is Crohn disease, Crohn-like disease, because there are so many similarities between the Crohn and Behçet disease. There's just, you know, the vascular involvement is major differential diagnosis between two disorders, because Behçet, as we know, can cause the vasculitis. And the last group is vascular disease. And as I told you at the beginning of my talk, it's a multi-system disorder with recurrent manifestations. As you can see, the disease can involve all kind of systems, organs, like a mucocutaneous findings or gastrointestinal system involvement, musculoskeletal involvement or cutaneous involvement, neurological CNS involvement, ocular involvement, or lichen vasculitis. This is the first symptom, actually, for the Behçet, and this is we can come across in our patients almost more than 90% of our patients. This is the earliest manifestations and required for the diagnosis, actually, and this is also the first symptoms in general our pediatric population. And at least when they described for the oral aphthous ulcers in Behçet patients, they are saying that at least 3 times over a 12-month period it should be occurred. And generally, oral aphthous lesions are healing without any scarring. And you can see in all oral mucosa these oral aphthous lesions, as you can see in uvula or in heart palate or in tongue. And another important clinical manifestation is genital aphthous ulcers, almost seen in 70% of the patients. It's less often than oral ulcerations, and in general they are large, deep ulcers, and they are going to heal with scarring. The third, and most, in my opinion, this is the most important involvement in these patients, ocular inflammation, and it tends to occur early in the course of the disease. Recurrent and persistent ocular inflammation may lead to visual loss, and in this group of patients, we can see both anterior uveitis, posterior uveitis, or panuveitis, especially if you have any patients with the panuveitis, you have to rule out Behçet disease in your patients. The cutaneous manifestations is around 60 to 90%. It depends on the geographic area. And generally, we are going to see in our patients erythema nodosum or pseudofolliculitis and acneiform nodules. It's one of the erythema nodosum in a patient with Behçet disease. And Pathergy test, we are using also as a supportive diagnostic criteria for our patients. And some people classified in cutaneous involvement, but we know very well at the needle insertion area, the phenomenon is going to develop as an aseptic erythematous papule, nodule, or pustules, as you can see in this patient here. Vascular involvement is vascular and CNS involvement is one of the most important and dangerous involvement in the patients, and at least it's less seen when you compare with the cutaneous involvement or oral or genital aphthous lesions. It occurs in 7 to 29% of the patients. In general, the predominant in the male gender. There are four types of vascular lesions described in Behçet syndrome: arterial occlusions, venous occlusions, aneurysms, and varices. And you can see the superficial venous occlusions in these patients. Sometimes if the arteries can going to be affected, you can see the ulcers in like in this patient. And one of the very important involvement about the vasculitis is pulmonary artery involvement. You can see in this picture some different patients, and in here, for example, partially thrombosed pulmonary arteries you can see, or if you look at here, it's going to be completely thrombosed pulmonary arteries you can see. Other involvements is arthritis. We can see 50% of the patients, or gastrointestinal system involvement. It's around the 25%, and the patient has then also the lichen genital ulcers or oral ulcers can be seen in all gastrointestinal system. And in general, these patients are complaining about pain, anorexia, rectal bleeding, vomiting, and diarrhea. And luckily, the neurological involvement is the less one in all of the clinical manifestations. And most serious complications, high fatality rate, and severe headache is the most frequent symptom of the patients. And it's developed more than 5 years after Behçet disease is diagnosed. I just want to share you very briefly one of the our study. It's going to be, we are still working on it. And this is a pediatric Behçet syndrome manifestations and activity in the United States versus Turkey, a cross-sectional cohort comparison. I just want to show you the, if you look at here, the positive family history in Turkish patients, in Turkish children, it's really very high when you compare the US ones. And I want to show you another slides, like a clinical features. And please look at here. Oral ulcers is really very high in Turkish patients. Or if you go to the erythema nodosum, for example, and again, it's statistically very high when you compare the US children with Behçet disease. And if you look at here, the uveitis is really very high when you compare the US children, children with Behçet disease from the USA, US, United States, America. And again, other eye findings also very common in Middle East or Mediterranean area when we compare the disease in North America. It might be, we are working on the data, but I believe that environmental effects, you know, very important about the disease course and presentation. And if you look at this slide, you can see just some medications, but I believe that it's more related with the eye involvement. Because of this, we are using more azathioprine in our patients, or steroid eye drop, or prednisone. There are some diagnostic criteria, but for the, especially for the pediatric patients, the most important one, we have to be really first suspect from our patients if the patient has an recurrent oral lesions. Because also in this study that I showed you, the previous study, sorry, I went there. Okay. Also, in our preliminary study that I showed and I shared with you, the patient, especially during the childhood, when they started with the oral aphthous lesions, and they are going to complete their full criteria almost in 7 years. It means at the beginning, they have just oral aphthous lesions, and the second symptom going to add it in a 3 or 4 years, and the disease going to complete as a classification criteria or diagnostic criteria in 7 years. For the treatment, and I just want to show you the Ulcer guidelines for 2018, and I'm going to summarize from here. If you look at here, if the patient has a skin and mucosa involvement, we prefer to use topical corticosteroids, or also the coicin is one of the effective treatment modalities for skin mucosa involvement. And if there's also joint involvement, we can use the immunosuppressive therapy like an azathioprine, on we can use also interferon. And if you look at the here and uveitis, and for the venous thrombosis, azathioprine is one of the first choice for the treatment, and interferon gamma alpha also we can use it. Infliximab and adalimumab, these are coming mostly from the adult studies. These are but in pediatric practice, we are also using this guideline. Or if you look at the pulmonary or vascular involvement, if we say the vasculitis, sometimes we need the surgery for our patients, but if we don't need the surgery to apply for our patients, so cyclophosphamide is one of the first-line treatment for the patients with vasculitis. And infliximab, again, a second choice for this group. If the patient has a CNS involvement, and we need to use azathioprine, infliximab, or adalimumab, or if the patient has a gastrointestinal involvement, we have to use also 5-ASA or derivatives. As a summary of the treatment, if the patient has a mucocutaneous lesions, we have to start with coicin and topical and oral corticosteroids. For the eye involvement, we have to think about corticosteroids, can be locally or can be systemically used in our patients. And also, we have to think about immunosuppressive treatment, especially first-line azathioprine. If there is a major vein thrombosis, we have to think about corticosteroids, and immunosuppressive treatment can be combined with the anticoagulant treatment. If there is a neurologic involvement, steroids and immunosuppressive treatment should be performed. The morbidity and mortality, if you look at mortality, is very low, really. And in generally, the mortality that we saw in pulmonary aneurysms or vascular involvement with the Behçet disease. But the most common morbidity is, unfortunately, blindness in these patients. And I would like to thank all of my colleagues and all of my mentors in front of you. And thank you very much for giving me this opportunity again. Thanks a lot.